To be realistic, you have to believe in what the world tells you is not possible or realistic. That's kingdom culture. It's counterintuitive. This is why you have to be born again, to become a citizen of the kingdom of the living God. So that you can be an heir of the kingdom, and so there's no misunderstanding in communication. How many of you know this church is beautifully multicultural? It's beautifully diverse. Heaven is going to be diverse of every culture, every creed, every language. That's God's will, amen? How many of you know two different cultures can say the same word and mean two different things? You can do something in one culture that would complement some, and if you take that compliment from that culture into another culture and say that compliment or do that action, perform that action and behavior, it can totally insult the people of that culture. That's cultural confusion. You have to work through that in every relationship. You know why you have to be born again? And why being born again is not just breathing and existing, as Pastor said. It's living, learning the culture. So there's no misunderstanding when God speaks to you. So that when God says something, you know exactly what God means. Because you're not looking at it through the filter of your culture. You're looking at it through the filter of kingdom culture. That we were all born into. I'm not an apostolic of Texas. I'm an apostolic in the kingdom of God. You're not an apostolic of the Philippines or of Athens or Mississippi or wherever you're from, Oklahoma. You are an apostolic citizen in the kingdom of God. It's a global kingdom. It's the same thing everywhere you go. The stuff that can change doesn't matter that much. The stuff that can't is from God. We can't redefine how to approach Him. We can't redefine what it takes to please Him. These things cannot be moved from nation to nation, language to language, culture to culture. Why? Because it's kingdom culture and it works everywhere. It's Book of Acts culture. It's apostolic culture. That stuff can't be changed. It's real. That's why you have to be born again. So looking at sometimes how God understands something is totally different and counterintuitive than how I understand something. And there's no greater sign of this than Genesis 1. He doesn't even start his day like we do. How many of you think the day begins in the morning? Were you not raised that way? I kind of was. I was raised that way. I mean, it makes sense to us, right? Night is the end of our day. Now, I want you to think about that for a second. God said, I'm not going to end my day with darkness. I'm going to end my day in light. I'm not ending my day in chaos. I'm ending my day in order. That's the difference. God said, when I'm through with something, because when did He finish? At the end of the day, then He called it good. He never called darkness good, because the day that God never ended in darkness. It always ended in light. And He said, that is good. Think about that for a second. The God that made a day can change everything in your life in a day. I had a friend call me just a few weeks ago. He was floored. He was about to get kicked. He was about to lose his home. Horrible situation. No fault of his own. He had been making his payments, doing what he was supposed to do. Someone on the other end of that process completely denied their responsibilities, and he was going to be homeless as a result of that. He was crying. He didn't know what to do. He said, I just found out. In days, I have to leave. He was crying. He was very upset. One phone call can change your life. Right? Everybody knows that. But everyone focuses on the negative end of that. One phone call can change your life. Horrible things can happen. You know what God told me to tell him? Tell him, I made a day. And I can change everything in a day. And just like everything can fall apart with a single phone call, everything can come together with a single phone call. I can put it together just as quickly as it fell apart. God has that kind of creative power and ability. And I told him that. I said, God is about to show you He that made a day will change everything in a day. 24 hours later, in a brand new apartment, brand new place to live, far nicer than anything you could have ever imagined, with a $99 move-in special. That's a pretty big deal. $100, you can move into the place. Amazing. In one day, everything was changed. Everything he'd been praying about for months, he wanted out of that home anyway. He wanted out of that environment and out of that place. And everything he'd been praying about seems like it was all falling apart. And then 24 hours later, there was order. There was Erev. There was evening. And there was Boker. There was morning. Evening to morning. That's a day. God says, that's good. You know what evening means in Hebrew? Chaos. You know what morning means? Order. Do you see now why God said, I'm not ending my day in chaos? You can if you want to, but I'm not going to end my day with chaos. When I'm through in a situation, there will be order. Where there was chaos, there will be order. God can change everything in your life in one day. God ends his day with light, not night. That's kingdom culture. It's totally counterintuitive to how we do things. That's why a holiday, Passover, that was last Friday, began Friday night. It's the beginning. You see, we look at things sometimes and we call it the end. And God says, you don't understand, son. I'm just getting started. What you call the end, I call the beginning. Because I'll never end something in chaos. I will never end something detached from purpose. Your life is full of purpose because God is not a God of random or arbitrary. God is a God of purpose. God is a God of light. In him is no darkness. Another way to say that, in him is no chaos. In him is no disorder. In him is perfect order, perfect light, beauty and holiness. That is God. He's not going to end something in your life. If God is working something in your life and leading you and guiding you, it's not going to end in chaos. If you feel chaos, what you need to know is it's the start of a new day in your life. It's not the end of a new day in your life. It's the beginning of something else. It's the beginning of the creative process. Whatever remains chaotic, when God is through, will be in order. Confusion will give way to clarity. Amen? If you're seeking direction tonight, I'm here to tell you and to prophesy to you in the name of the Lord God. The chaos you feel is the sign of a beginning of a new season, not the end of anything. God has just begun. And when he's through in this season, there will be light. There will be order. You will see the steps that you are to take. It'll be clear. It'll be very clear. God orders our steps. Didn't say he orders 1,000 in a row. We would like that. I would like that, especially right now in our life. But he said, order your steps. It's a lamp unto your feet, a light unto your path. You can only see this part, but you can see it clearly. God gave me a vision one time. I was kneeling on a road, and I looked up, and there were letters, Hebrew letters, written all the way down as far as I could see. But I could only read the ones that were right in front of me. And as I traveled, they came up off the pavement and went inside me. God's word came inside my mind and my spirit. He said, you can only receive what is meant for you in the season. Everything else was blurry. You couldn't even read it. He said, when you're trying to look beyond your season, you're going to get confused. If you can't see letters clearly, you'll read something that's not there. That's what the Lord was showing me. You're trying to look too far into your future instead of trusting me that I am already there because I'm not bound by time. I'm already in your future. And if you try to read it, you'll get another message that possibly isn't even there. But you just wait for it. Everything is beautiful in its season. That means out of its season, it's not beautiful. It's ugly because it's out of its time. Amen? So be encouraged in the Spirit tonight. Now, like we said, the way God starts his day, phenomenal, truly phenomenal. He begins with chaos, always ends with order. God cannot end with disorder. He cannot end with a lack of goodness, which means connected to purpose. Now, if we come into agreement with the darkness, now, just to let you know, to share something personal, the enemy will often torment you. If you have to travel, you have to travel a lot. The enemy will torment you. Anytime it's a significant trip, Pastor, the enemy tries to torment me that I won't return from it. That it'll be my last one. All the time. And so the Lord gave me a dream one time. The Lord gave me an interpretation of a dream that the enemy was trying to cause fear in. I kept seeing these planes that were crashing. And that's very disturbing if you're about to get on a plane. You don't want to dream of a plane crash. And so I kept seeing, I would have these dreams so vivid and real, these planes crashing in fields. And I was just like, come on, you've got to be kidding me. I could even hear the chaos in the pilot's voice. It's like I was connected to the cockpit as they were going down. It's like I was connected to the black box. And I was like, what is going on? Finally, the Lord stopped me and said, I want you to notice something, son. You're an observer in every single one of these dreams. Because the enemy doesn't have the power to put you on one that's going down. So he has to make you watch as another one goes down. If he could put you on one that was going down, he would have done it by now. But I've told him no. Think about that for a moment. He's trying to cause fear. If I were to agree with him, come into alignment with the kingdom of darkness, and fear, it would bring things into existence that the enemy wanted to bring into reality in my life. This would cause me to have something in common with the enemy, thereby giving him power over me. When you enter common ground with darkness, darkness takes dominion over you instantly. You cannot have dominion in his realm of darkness. It's not going to work. You're not going to take the world by the throat and get everything you want. It is going to eviscerate you. He has dominion in darkness. God's allowed that. So the only reason he can ever have it is because God has allowed it. It's delegated to him. So in destruction and chaos and darkness and sensuality, he has dominion over that nonsense. So if you enter that realm, you have put yourself in a position you cannot win. It'll take your mind, your marriage, your relationships, your money, everything. It will completely rob you of anything that has a value and give you things that are synthetic, that have no value at all. Now, when you enter common ground, commonality with darkness, what happens is the destiny of darkness becomes your reality. Destruction, chaos, fear, anxiety. But when you come into agreement with the kingdom of God, which is light, Messiah's destiny, Messiah's heritage, the work of Jesus on the cross becomes your reality. So what you need to do is let the Creator create on the canvas of your mind and come into agreement with the kingdom of God. Then the opposite of darkness becomes your reality. Messiah's destiny, Messiah's heritage becomes yours. That's grace. The creative power of God to bring through you what you will never deserve. His work is the center of the gospel, not mine. Amen? His work is the center, not mine. Any work I do, anything I do, is to please him. It's not to make things happen for me. It's to please the one that saved me. Because his work is the center of the gospel, not my work. It's an amazing and different perspective to see the gospel by. But that's grace. Grace creates in us. Doesn't mean you just sit by and God's grace does everything for you and you have to do nothing. So you can live a perverse life and live a prayerless life and live a fast-free life and live a consecration-less life because the grace of God can do everything for you. No, God's grace will do everything for you, but if you don't please God, his grace is removed from you. It's a relationship. So I have to please him. That's the power of his kingdom. It bursts through me what I never deserve. But what I deserve is not my destiny in the kingdom of God. But if I come into commonality with darkness, their destiny flows through me. And their destiny is hopelessness. Their destiny, the evil side, their destiny is to be lost. Their destiny is to forever be estranged from the God that created them. Forever. There is no hope for them. They sinned in eternity, not time. There is no hope for them. That's why when you feel the presence of evil, you feel hopelessness. There is no gospel for them. That's why the angels look into this message of salvation. It intrigues them because it's not possible for them. They are eternally with God, or they have chosen to be away from him. A third of the host chose to be away from him. So if you enter in the domain of darkness, that destiny becomes your reality. Amen?
Amen.
That's the culture of God. Very, very quickly, coming to a close. My pastor called me and showed me something about the Lord's Prayer that I had not seen before. And it truly blew my mind. But just to prove how the kingdom is so counterintuitive, it's opposite human intuition in every possible way. When you pray the Lord's Prayer, listen to the tense that God prayed it in, that Jesus spoke it in. Did he say, "My Father who art in heaven, deliver me from evil. Free me from sin." No. He said, "Our Father, deliver us. Lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from evil." He took the me and my out of it. The me and the my is missing. He said, if you're going to have a kingdom mind, you have to take self-ambition out of your prayer. It's not just about you. It's about him, and it's about us. It's our Father. We are one in the kingdom. We are one as citizens in the kingdom culture. Our Father who art in heaven, deliver us, Almighty God. Lead us, Almighty God. It's collective. It's communal. It's a culture. It's a body. It binds us together. In secular society, you have idolatry. You have selfishness. In the interest of time, I can't fully express everything here. Musicians, you can come. Give the people hope. Amen. One of the high points of the kingdom is humility. And Pastor told me, he just spoke about humility, so I'm not going to rehash all of that. But humility takes the me out of it. Surely does. It takes the selfishness out. Because in the secular realm, it's got to be you, right? It's what you can do. It's about you and your interest, your bottom line, your agenda, what you want. The kingdom is the total opposite of that. Humility is the backbone of the kingdom. Humility is like stealth technology. The enemy can't even see what God is doing in your life properly if you ask him to clothe you, ask God to clothe you in humility. That's why they saw Jesus, but had no idea who he really was. For had they known, they would have never crucified the Lord of glory. Had they known? They didn't know. Why didn't they know? What brings confusion into the sinister side of the spirit realm? Humility. Because they don't understand that. Because what does the devil want more than anything? To be like the Most High. He'll never be like the Most High. But what is his desire? To be the man. To be in charge. To be the epicenter of everything that's going on. For everyone to ooh and ah and look at his talent and ability. The jewels and the pipes in his body. He wanted everyone to look at his talent. His ability. What he missed was, in the kingdom, it's not about talent or ability. It's about transferability. Can you let it flow through you, knowing your confidence is in who is flowing through you, not your ability to let it flow? You're a vessel. You're light flowing through a vessel. You're a prism of the presence of Almighty God. And humility is not a lack of confidence. It's confidence recalibration. It's confidence set in order. That my confidence is in God. My confidence is in His anointing, His ability, His power, His grace, His love, His peace. It's not in me. I don't get value from my education. I don't get value from my clothing. I don't get value from my car. Has God provided excellence in all of those things? Yes. And will He? Yes. But that is not to be a source of value. It just shows off His grace. It shows off His favor. It shows off His ability to bless His people. But never was it intended for those things to give His people value. Read Ezekiel 15. You'll find that out quickly. God clothes His people in beauty. And then they turn around and make idols out of it. You know what that means? That started giving them value. God blessed me with a nice suit. God blessed me with a nice car. God blessed me with a good education. God blessed me with a high-paying job. I'm valuable because of that. No. You're valuable because you're His. You're valuable because He loves you. You're valuable because you have a relationship with Him. That's what makes you valuable. Anything else that gives you value becomes an idol. Very quickly. Anything that leads you that is not God has just become an idol in your life. It is taught in Israel, anger can be an idol. It can be. It can motivate you to do good. There's a righteous indignation. We're very aware of that. But if you're angry all the time and anger is driving your behavior, you have become a slave to anger. The man that pulls up in front of the nice hotel in a Ferrari and throws the keys to the valet driver and says, park in the shade, is a slave to the compliments of men. That's why he's driving a Ferrari. Because people ooh and ah and go crazy over that. That's what gives him value. If what people thought was awesome was a Volkswagen Beetle, that's what he'd be driving. He's a slave to the word of man and women, not the word of God. But if you have humility, if God is creating true humility in you, true humility is never going to cause you to say, oh, it can never be us. No, it can never be me. No. That's not humility, guys. God said it would be you. God said you will be blessed. God said He would put His anointing on you. And God said He would loose ministry through you. The ministry of the saint. The fivefold ministry equips the saints for what? The work of ministry. His presence is supposed to flow through you into the lives of other people. In your life. People at your job. Wherever you go. That's what gives you value. That you're His. That you and I are purchased by the same thing, His sinless blood. If something is bought for the same price as something else, their value is the same. The same thing that bought you is the same thing that bought me. Our value is tethered forever to His holy work on Calvary's cross. We're bought with a price. Too precious to quantify with mere numbers. We're bought with the price of His holy blood. A sinless Savior. God wants to bless you in a powerful way. Your day, your season is not going to end in chaos. God wants to show you what it means to be blessed by Him. He wants to strengthen you and align your mind with His holy kingdom. We stand together all over this house tonight as they prepare to sing. I just want you to lift your hands unto the Lord and ask Him to bathe your mind in His peace and in His Spirit. Say, God, align my thoughts with Your own. Align my motivations with Your kingdom, God. Let Your sovereignty invade my self-sufficiency. Because my sense of self-sufficiency was an illusion at best and a deception at worst. God, in Your name, free us, mighty King, from every idol in our life. Free us, God, from anything that puts us in agreement with darkness. We want nothing in common with the enemy. We want nothing in common with darkness and chaos. Loose a kingdom mind in this place, God, as never before. Loose the brightness of Your coming in this room, in our minds, oh God, and destroy the worker of iniquity. Destroy, oh God, the kingdom of darkness. Let Your kingdom be manifested in this house as never before. Let Your kingdom be released. Let Your presence be released, oh God, right now. Oh, in Jesus' name. Lord, can you clap your hands to the Lord right now? Jesus, thank You, Holy Father. Glory to Your name. There is no one like You. There is no one like You, Jesus. I'm going to ask you to come and stand around the front here at this altar area. In our closing moments, I know the hour is getting late. In the closing moments of this service, I want you to lift your hands. I want you to come if you need peace in your mind, if you need clarity. In His presence is the fullness of joy. Amen? Joy is the strength of the kingdom. The joy of the Lord is my strength. If I use that strength to resist the devil and resist darkness and remove all commonality, anything in common with him, he will flee. Resist the devil, he will flee. That's the word of God. His presence is here. His presence and voice cannot be separated. They are forever tethered together. He will create in you by His presence. He will give you joy. He will give you peace that crushes the enemy, that removes his influence from your mind. If you need clarity in a situation, lift your hands. If direction is what you seek, lift your hands unto the Lord and cry out unto Him in worship, and He will give you clarity. He will remove confusion so that you see clearly the path in this season you are to take. Oh, that's it. Cry out to the Lord right now. Oh, as they begin to sing, just cry out to Him. Oh, in the name of Jesus. Yes, oh God. Yes, oh God.
special has happened in this house tonight. A number of you, if not all of us. But our minds have been rearranged. Our minds have been rearranged. You see, because each and every one of us, we're now kingdom-minded. God has given us a new mind. Amen. And we have tangible proof. Because wherever we go now, and it's been happening, but it's amplifying, it's ramping up. But we are no longer seeking the blessing to be blessed. But we are the blessers. And more is being dispersed into you, which you are in turn going to be dispersing out. I'll give you an example. Today, brother, we took the brother out to get some food. Well, when we went there, there was no business. But before we left, the place was full. Now that just don't happen once. That happens all the time. Because we are the anointed ones. We have this power. And wherever you go, people are going to be touched by this power, by this blessing, by this light. Praise the Lord. I know you may have noticed in your life, where you go, you bring blessing. In your employer's house, you know why they love you so much? Not because of you, it's because of this blessing you have with you. Praise the Lord. Because you bring blessing wherever you go, you bring blessing. And what you're going to do now is try to realize the force that you are, and release it. That's why he preached last time, releasing the kingdom. Release it. Now we got a new duty. We got to shut down these honky tonks around here, these clubs. So when you walk by those clubs, you just release that power on that club. Says, in the name of Jesus, we shut you down. Hallelujah. Amen. I felt something about that. I think that is going to be a witness. Praise the Lord. I should be telling the devil all of our tricks here. But when you go by these places, put the Spider-Man thing on, okay? Amen. And let that flow out. Praise God. Praise God. And just everywhere you go, just you don't have to go up and shake people. Put your hand on their head and just walk by them and just whisper, bless them, dear Lord. God, you will work your work in this place. God, work your work in these families. Bless this home. Just go blessing everything because you've got that now. And what's going to happen more and more, as the end time approaches, that is coming on, we're being endued with more and more of this power, more and more of this blessing power. Praise God. And it's going to be amazing. There's going to be people, you're going to be praying something, walk by somebody on the street, and you just say, in the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. It'll probably scare you what's happened. They got up and walk. What happened? You know, it's just because that's who we are. Just the other night, I was telling you about how God, before the foundation of the world, decided he had to have something special. Angels couldn't do it. Serpents couldn't do it. Cherubims couldn't do it and all that. He said, I got to have something special far beyond the world. why he said, I want to have a church. I want to have people. I want to, and so I want to produce blood to make sure that they can come through and be worthy, hallelujah, of my eternal reward. Glory to God. We're special. God looks down upon us. We are like jewels. Throughout, we are the jewels. Amen. Say, I am somebody. See, you are. I am somebody. This little dynamite right here, hallelujah, you just pay attention what you do. You bring more blessing than you realize. Just pay attention to what you do. So, I mean, you go to places and you just start. You know how the little girl comes down the aisle in front of the bride and the groom? She's got these little fire petals and she's throwing these little rose petals everywhere. Hallelujah. Well, we're just going to walk through life. We're throwing rose petals everywhere. Right in the corner where you are. And you're just going to rhythm. You say, wow, look what's going on. This is awesome. Amen. And somehow or another, God's going to parlay all of that into a great gathering in. Amen. Is that all right, Brother Adams? I didn't mean to try and preach on top of you. That's awesome. You got me excited. The whole thing is you got me stirred up. Got me on top. Hallelujah. So thank y'all, folks. Hey, we a little later tonight, but it's worth it. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Clap your hands. Tomorrow, Pascha, amen, and we're going to have special communion in the first part of the service tomorrow, and then we're going to turn to Evangelist Luce again, and we'll see what he's going to pop us with, amen, and we're going to have a wonderful day in the Lord tomorrow. Amen. I've got a big, good dinner ready for tomorrow after church, but we're not going to get in a hurry today.